Even with the Raspberry Pi prices back to normal, the BTT Pi is a great alternative for Klipper conversions thanks to its affordability, features and performance. Hello, my fellow 3D printers! Let's check out the BTT Pi. I show you how I converted my Delta FLSun QQ-S Pro 3D printer to run with Klipper using the BTT Pi. For other 3D printers, the conversion works the same, except for the configuration, which must be adjusted specifically depending on the 3D printer model. I'll go through the preparation of the system and I'll give you several tips on how to avoid some of the pitfalls on the way to a working installation, like an all-white touchscreen. Then I show the basic configuration for the FLSun QQ-S Pro and take it to the test. As in every Big Tree Tech shipping, the package contains the rubber duck, a huge cooler, the BTT Pi, a cable to connect an ADXL 345 accelerometer and a Wi-Fi antenna. If you want to use a TFT display, then you need an SPI driven display. It's connected to the BTT Pi's SPI display connector with a supplied FFC cable. The BTT Pi's form factor is the same than that of a Raspberry Pi, but its mass of connectors required Big Tree Tech to position them differently from the Pi. So you can't use a Raspberry Pi case. Still, there are several options for cases to choose from on Thingiverse printables and things, so you find one you like there. The performance of the BTT Pi is comparable to the Raspberry Pi 3B Plus, but is packed with dedicated connectors. 4 USB 2 ports. The MKS Pi shown in my other video only had 3, but one was USB 3. A fast Ethernet port and onboard Wi-Fi with 100 megabit per second. A separate CAN bus connector. To enable and make use of it, you need an add-on USB to CAN module that goes on the two black headers on the board. Then just 4 wires are enough to go to the EBB CAN V1.2 board that controls the stepper motor, heater, thermistor, RGB lights, probe and more. An HDMI 2.0 port, which can output up to 4K video, a 3.5mm audio jack, a USB-C connector to power the board with 5 volts using an adequate USB-C power brick. Next to it is a jumper, but more on that later. An SPI display port, which you can use to connect the optional touch screen. Unfortunately, this is not the same as the Raspberry Pi display connector, so you need to get a compatible SPI TFT display. I'm using the TFT35 SPI in this video. A port to connect an ADXL 345 accelerometer. It looks somehow proprietary to me, and BQ offers ADXL 345 boards with that connector. Located next to the ADXL connector is a screw terminal to supply power to the board. It accepts 12 to 24 volt as input. An IR receiver, which can be used to send commands using an IR remote. Think of turning your 3D printer's main power supply using a remote or other fancy stuff like LED lights on and off and more. The color-coded 40-pin GPIO allows easy identification of the pins per process. There's a comprehensive overview in the BTT Pi's user manual, which is available on the according GitHub page. It does not only show the purpose and function of each pin, but also compares it to other boards like Big Tree Tech's CB1 or the Raspberry CM4. A good resource if you plan to connect and control more things with the board later. Below the GPIO pin is a separate PWM-enabled fan connector. For setting things up, I installed Berliner Etcher to flash the SD card with the system image, Notepad++ to edit files, PuTTY and WinSCP to access the BTT Pi over SSH, the latter making it easy to transfer files between the PC and the BTT Pi. There are 2 system images provided for installation. A minimalistic one, having just the basic system, and one which is pre-configured with Klipper. To keep it easy, I take the latter, of course. You'll find the link to it as well as the other resources mentioned throughout the video in the description. I won't show the complete flashing process here, since I've already done that in my video about the Makerbase MKS Pi. The only difference is that I use the BTT Pi image instead of the MKS Pi image. Then I edit the configuration located in the root folder of the SD card. To get access to it, I take the SD card out and back in and open the file in Notepad++. I change the Wi-Fi SSID and Wi-Fi password values to match my Wi-Fi credentials, and I uncomment and change the time zone to the one of my location. For convenience, a custom hostname can be set as well. Since I already ran into the pitfall that my TFT display stayed white, here's my first tip. In the boardenv.txt file, uncomment the line hash overlays equals TFT35SPI by removing the leading hash. Now I put the SD card into the BTT Pi's SD card slot. Then I use the provided FFC cable to connect the TFT display to the BTT Pi. There are two choices to provide power to the board. Either a 5V USB-C plug-in power supply with at least 2 amps, which is plugged into the USB-C port of the BTT Pi, or using the terminals for the 12-24V supply and connect it to the power supply of the 3D printer. If you want to use this to power the board, then the earlier mentioned jumper has to be in its open position. When using USB-C to power the board, the jumper has to be closed and you should not connect another power supply to the terminal block. Don't forget to connect the Wi-Fi antenna unless you prefer using a LAN connection to get access to the board in your home network. Time to let the electrons do their work. The BTT Pi should boot, showing a boot screen and after a short moment the Klipper screen on the display. To open the Klipper UI in the web browser as well as to make an SSH connection for the final setup steps, I try the hostname set earlier and if that doesn't work, I figure out the IP address of the BTT Pi. Most videos tell you now to go into your router's network overview to look up the IP address and of course you could do that, but there's a much easier way. Touch the gear icons on the touch screen to open the settings, then touch the network and there's the IP address. I could enter it into my browser's address bar or even simpler, enter the hostname I've set. In usual home network environments, that should do the trick. If the video already provided some useful information, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. If everything is working, then the Klipper UI is loaded. Since the required configuration for the printer hasn't been provided yet, there's an error. Two pieces are missing. The 3D printer configuration, so that Klipper knows how to control it, and the printer has not been flashed with the required firmware yet. For the FLSun, I found a pretty good configuration on GitHub, which I'll be using here. For any other printer, you may find a well-made configuration as well, or use one of the configurations which come with Klipper. If I hadn't a pre-made configuration, then I'd go into the Klipper config directory and look up the configuration for the 3D printer, select it and press Shift plus F5 to duplicate it, then replace Klipper with printer_data in the target remote path. Now go to the printer_data config folder. I copied my downloaded configuration to that folder instead. Besides other configuration files, there's the just copied configuration and the printer.cfg file. I open it in the editor and replace the generic BigTreeTech config with the name of my configuration. Next, I open the printer configuration. The commands at the top of the file contain all the information needed to configure and compile the Klipper firmware. Then I start a PuTTY session, type BQ for the password and enter to open an SSH terminal. After going into the Klipper directory, executing make menu config opens the settings for the Klipper compilation. I change the configuration according to the commands in the config file and save the changes by pressing Escape and Y. Back on the command line, executing the make command starts the compilation. After it has finished, one may need to execute additional commands to prepare the firmware for flashing. In my case, I have to execute a script. Depending on how the update procedure for your 3D printer looks like, you have to copy the created binary to an SD card, a USB stick, or in rare cases can flash it directly by using the information found in the printer config. The FLSun QQ-S Pro has to be flashed using an SD card. Fifth tip, before flashing make sure that you have the original firmware at hand in case something goes wrong or that you want to revert back to the original firmware. Search for it on the manufacturer support website and put it in a safe place. After successfully flashing, I remove the SD card, connect the 3D printer to the BTT Pi and restart it. Back in the main cell UI in the web browser, I restart the firmware and Klipper should find and connect to the 3D printer. Now it's a good time to add some macros to the printer config. I just copy the macros from the Klipper screen documentation and paste them at the end of the configuration. To prevent the error move exceeds maximum extrusion length, I open the configuration file containing the extruder section and add max extruder only distance 500 at the end of that section. I add the start print and end print macros as well. They serve as a replacement for the slicer start and end G code, making the generated G-code more independent so that it can be printed on different 3D printers without changes. To do so, I copy the G-code from my slicer's 3D printer profile into the G-code section of the macros. Then I replace the slicer start and end G-code with start print and end print. Because of the already installed crow's nest, using a webcam to watch the 3D printer remotely is as easy as connecting it to one of the BTT Pi's USB ports and adding the webcam in the webcam section of the interface settings. Before doing the first print, the 3D printer has to be calibrated. This is depending on the 3D printer and the procedure may vary. If you have a bad slinger, then you can watch my video about the MKS Pi to get detailed instructions on how to do the bed leveling, calibrate pressure advance and tune input shaping. I continue going quickly over the procedure for Delta printers like my FLSun QQ-S Pro. First, I calibrate my nozzle's Z offset. I connect and attach the Z probe switch and home the printer with G28. Then I use probe calibrate to start. After removing the probe, I do the paper test to adjust the nozzle's height and use accept and save config to save it. The first step is done. Klipper still doesn't know about the exact delta parameters like arm lengths and so on, but it has a nice tool to help. I home the printer, reattach the probe and start Delta Calibrate. Klipper begins probing several points on the build plate and calculates the delta parameters afterward. Again, save config persists the values and I restart Klipper to make sure they are active. Albeit that already enables me to print things, there still may be dimensional accuracy issues. I account for that using Klipper's Delta Analyze tool. The tool requires printing a calibration object. Then the values measured on that object are given to the Delta Analyze tool and saved again. Let me know in the comments if you'd like to see an in-depth guide on how to do the calibration for a Delta 3D printer or others. For pressure advance tuning, I suggest the pattern method as described in the excellent Alice 3D print tuning guide. It's fast and uses less material than other methods while giving good results. In my case, looking at the pattern gives roughly a pressure advance value of 0.65, which I add to the end of the extruder section in the printer configuration. Next, you'll want to get an ADXL345 accelerometer working. Add the shown ADXL345 section to the printer config. To get it working, enable the SPI dev in the board environment file. The easiest way is to SSH into the BTT Pi using PuTTY to open the file and append it to the uncommented overlay line, separated with a space. Sixth tip, one can quickly read over the command at the end of the board environment file. To make the active overlays work, they must be written in one line, separated by a space. Otherwise, the last line will take precedence, overwriting all previously active overlays. You can go on to connect the ADXL and after a reboot, it should be recognized. To calibrate the input shaping parameters, I printed a mount for my ADXL345 with a magnet so that I can attach it to the FLSun's printhead like the Z probe. You can find ADXL mounts for the most popular 3D printers on Printables and Thingiverse. I followed the steps outlined in the Klipper documentation for resonance compensation. Using an accelerometer, it's as easy as running Shaper Calibrate. It tests the resonances for each axis and calculates the input shaping parameters, suggesting the one that suits best. After another save config and Klipper restart, my FLSun QQ-S Pro's basic setup is done. What's left to do is to write or choose my favorite G-code macros to add and tweak them to my needs. To confirm that prints are better now, I use the same G-code to print a part, which came out with lots of ghosting, a second time after the conversion. The result needs no words. I really liked getting to run Klipper on my 3D printer using the BTT Pi, still not using its full potential. The countless connectivity options leave plenty of room for extensions. Compared to the MKS Pi, the setup is almost as easy. There were some little issues that I had to get around, but nothing serious. It's nice that it has separate connectors for the CAN bus and the accelerometer. Thank you so much for watching. If you found this video helpful or entertaining, I'd really appreciate it if you would subscribe to my channel and help it to break the magic 1K subscribers barrier. Happy 3D printing and see you next here on 3D Printing Geek!